through there at the weekends, because I'd go over there and his brother played a wee bit, and so did his other wee brother. Yeah. But his dad had played for Trent Juniors that season that won 6-1 in the Scottish Cup against Peter's Hill.
Yeah.
And that particular day was when it all started, because Bob and I were only, I think, 9 at the time, so, and we're all sleeping in the one room, his two brothers and myself. And George says, "You better get up early because my dad's taking you two up to the park to play football."
Aye.
Anyway, we went through in the morning and he's polished the tee ball. Always remember, he's polished the tee ball in black boot polish and put a white lace in it.
Aye.
He's got the ball under it and we walked up through the wee area that you go through. He says, "Right, we're going to have crossing in and you're each going to cross 12, then another 12, then another 12, then another 12. Yeah. But you've got to dive and heed of the ball because that was a Saturday that Laurie Riley scored in the last minute with a dive and heed of
it.
And that is a true story because Bob and I used to practice that every morning. So that's what we used to do. His dad used to do it, and his dad was so keen in football, you wouldn't believe it.
Yeah, yeah.
And he had us diving for heeders.
Yeah.
But yes, heeding the ball and with that lace and the white lace, no only me.
Yeah.
All my friends have got problems now.
Yeah.
But they'll no admit it, and they'll say, no, we're no good, because it means probably they're thinking, well, we'll get to give them some money in that, but you shouldn't be thinking that.
No, accepting the fact. Absolutely.
Doctors as well,
learning from that. But, but it's, you know, we're talking about the football.
Jimmy Miller's story, he's come to my head.
Former Rangers.
And it's the memories as well, with other things, obviously, with other ailments. They can't tell you. I'm talking to you guys because I'm talking about something that's 100 years ago. But, you know, 2 minutes ago, I don't know what.
Is it something that needs?
I don't. 2 minutes ago, your name.
I've
still not got your name yet.
I'm the same way.
But I've got to try and learn to see.
School football with some of them play junior, some of them play the amateur. Uh-huh. We play every Monday night. And the pitch we play outdoors, and the pitch that we normally play on is getting relayed just now out at the racecourse at Lanark.
Mm-hmm.
So we're playing up at Lanark Grammar at the AstroTurf there.
Uh-huh.
So Monday night, due to go there for 8 o'clock, 6 o'clock, I get a text through for the guy who organises it. The game's off.
Uh-huh.
Frost. I couldn't believe it.
Yeah.
We're before the end of October.
Uh-huh.
And the game's off for Frost. Now, every one of the guys would have watched themselves. You wouldn't want to slip her up.
But health and safety
now, where people say, you can't play.
1963, I played with St Mirren, and it was the only game that was on in Britain.
Yeah.
Uh-huh.
And it was at Capello, and that was the depth of snow.
Aye.
Yeah.
Aye.
And Hal Stewart, wasn't you know what he was like, and he wanted to put on a show for the fans. It was a great game, 3 each. And the bonus was whatever team won, they get a canteen, a couple of each.
And
we lost the toss, we never get in.
Yeah.
You wouldn't believe the game.
But
to get back to what you're saying, Gavin, I bet you all support me. I don't think players practice. In your day, you could have bought your feet hour after hour. Remember you telling me that game, you played Dory or something.
That was a line, that was a baseline, and that was a door there, that mirror. And I used to play one against one at that door. Up there was the drying greens for all the women in Beggs Building, so if you went into there, and the guy got 2 shots, but you were hitting the ball against his door. Don't ask me why, but the game was up to 7.
Uh-huh. Right.
And then whoever was winning, you went through the final, and then it was up to 12.
Yeah,
didn't you ask me what the rules
were? No.
The other thing is that we were talking about last week, actually, was in a Sunday, if you went up to the Meadows in Edinburgh, it would be 20 games, and then you'd no see a game.
If you're living
in villages and that, the young guys were playing a game, and the younger guys were playing a game. It was all minors around where I was, and then they would come up with their bloody pip boots on, and you'd get kicked up and tied down. And then you just had to go on with it.
It has to be all organised.
Young kids are not playing in the public parks anymore.
I was, many years ago.
Sorry to just interrupt you because my memory will go, but she's talking about that as well. The kids, kiss there, yeah, if I go, what you say there?
All about the number of kids playing games and
computers.
Aye, if they didn't play off the pitch, then they'll not play at all time. That's the unfortunate thing.
It's all coaching,
I was at a conference a year ago when I was at college, it was about the inner game. Trust the body, tame the mind. and I had a lot of football questions. And you know what this fellow says to me? And the summary was, does it ever occur to you that the best players played when there weren't any books, there weren't any coaches, played.
And
that's what's wrong. There are too many books, there are too many coaches, and the flair's gone. You think of the players you played against and watched, and the talent had in every team, Gavin. Yeah. Look at you. See Tommy Bryson, what did I play? He was.
And the amount of players that played.
Yeah.
Tommy Bryson, I can remember getting off the bus at Murrow at
Lovesey.
The bus was a wee bit early, it must have been because they were waiting on Tommy Bryson, and he came up in his motorbike with a black hat on and that. That's what he did.
Yeah.
That's how he went to games. He didn't go to any game other than on his bike.
He put that. He came back to St. Mirren. St. Mirren played Norwich in a charity match, and he was a hero in the horseshoe. Right. Tommy Bryson. So there were hundreds of folk in this big civic centre in Paisley. So Bryson got up. I would like to say a few words.
But in your day, you would be playing with the school in the morning, on Saturday morning, and then the Saturday afternoon you'd be playing with the BBs or the amateur team.
I was clever because I was playing rugby.
And at Motherwell, you had Andy Payton and Ian Gardner and Johnny Aitkenhead and stuff, all these kind of people. And then I suppose I modelled myself, and I would love to be able to play like the Ansell Babes. My three favourite teams of all time are the Ansell Babes, the Celtic team that won the European Cup 1967, and Real Madrid, the team that played at Hampden in 1960. Because to me, they epitomise everything about Bruce. And Wally McSaveny asked me to play in the reserves, and I'm indebted to Wally McSaveny for what he did, because he obviously spoke for me, and I signed for Motherwell, and that was my first involvement with Motherwell. And sadly, I played about, I think about, in total, counting the Lanarkshire Cup games, maybe 10 games in the first team there. Bobby Watson, I couldn't get in for him, but I played as a midfield player. I never played there in my life. I never played in Murrell's first team as a defender, so I got freed at the end of that season, and I was fortunate enough to sign for Arbroath, and I played 5 years there. So in 1978, Roger Hind, that time I was teaching at Lanark Grammar School, and Roger was the Murrell manager, and I'd known Roger a long while, and he asked me, when I finished my playing days, he asked me if I'd like to come and get involved with the reserve team at Fir Park, which I jumped at. And at that time Billy Campbell took the reserve, so I assisted him. So that was my first involvement with Motherwell as a non-player.
And then from there, you continued to be involved with the club right up to the cup final and beyond in 1991. So I think I know the answer to this, but what was the highlight of your time with Motherwell Football Club, both as a player and as a coach, as assistant manager?
To be honest, I had a lot of tremendous experiences, but first of all with Roger, and then Alan McLeod came, then Joe Wallace, Davy Hay, which I did, and that in itself, and everything about it was wonderful, and the game, and then the next day afterwards, these are things that you'll never forget. So that was without a doubt the highlight of my overall career, Gavin, to be honest.
And in your time at Motherwell, you must have seen and played with some fantastic players. Out of all the players you met over the years here at Motherwell, who are the top players for you, your experience?
You mean as playing alongside or just working with?
Working with as a coach.
I've said this often. I played against Davy Cooper and I played for Arbroath, and it was a lovely sunny day, also remember that, and when I came down to Kilbowie, the park was frozen solid. And the Albert Henderson, our both manager, was going berserk because he hadn't brought footwear for the surface, and we got absolutely destroyed, and David Cooper destroyed us that day. And that was my first meeting him, and then I took reserve, Motherwell reserve teams against him, and always thought he was a good player. but I never realised how wonderful a player he was till I saw him closely and worked a lot with him. I used to take the training, and wee Wally McLean said to me once, you know, you want to see Coop at the training, they can't get the ball off him. And when he finished playing, Tommy McLean said to me, I want Coop to get involved with the reserves. I want him to take the reserves 1 week and you the next to get him the experience. I says, fine. And honestly, I could never think of the right words to say at the end of it. Played in these reserve games, and I used to say, David, thanks for letting me see you. It's a funny thing. I couldn't express how I felt. It was just a sheer joy. It was like a magician. So he was out, and there's some... I've had a lot of good discussions about players. I think I've got a talent, a gift, just a grace, like McAllister, Bobby Russell, players like that. McLean was in some ways was an enigma. He could be like that at other times, but there was just, at that time, there was a lot of tremendous, and the team I played with a high regard for Tom Forsyth as a player, he was a good friend of mine. He was a right swashbuckling inside forward at that time, and Joe Wark and David Whiteford, they were sterling fullbacks.
Yeah.
And at that time, Big Mac and Ali played them well. Bobby Watson was a good player. So there were a lot of good players. In my time working at Motherwell, was certainly, and Phil O'Donnell was another outstanding talent.
Yeah.
He was just a machine, but he was a wonderful player going forward. And Tom Boyd, there's just so many of them. But when you look back at even at the footage of the old games, the time you were involved, you never realised just how good a team they were.
Yeah,
And when you look at the success rate of Tommy McLean and his tenure at Motherwell, a very, very successful. And he in my opinion, was a wonderful brain, Tommy McLean.
Yeah.
And so had Tom Forsyth. I used to say, I wonder if I was full time I would get like that. But they just could see things I just couldn't see.
Yeah,
just
in
a different wavelength.
Yeah, excellent. So, come back to your playing days. Come back to your playing days. Who was your most difficult opponent? Who was the player you least liked playing against?
Oh, my most difficult player was a player that you had never heard of. And it was a fella called Jimmy Adam. At that time, Scotland had a prolific amount of wingers. That was right back at that time. I played all. I like to see you had Wally Johnson, Bobby Lennox, John Hughes, Arthur Duncan, there was just Tommy, Hugh Roberts, there was just so many of them. And there was a fella, Jimmy Adam, who played for Falkirk, and I could not get near him. He danced past, I could not get a tackle him. And I spoke to some of his ex-colleagues once, and I mentioned him, he says, well, he was some player, but he was a nutter. And he'd never ever been in. But the other one that sticks in my mind was, I was playing for Arbroath, and Doug Leash was an unknown player, and that was my favourite position was central defender, and I was marking him, and I remember giving us the series that I was playing. I never get one tackle at him. I could not see the ball. He just swivelled and moved about, and I come on us, and I was just completely amazed at how that fella could play.
Fantastic.
So he was the one, and the one that the fastest I would say was Wally Johnson.
Yeah.
Over a short period, he was a tremendous player. Wally Johnson, Eric Stevenson was another very good winger.
Hibs.
And they played against St Mirren. Used to play pre-season friendlies, and one of the finest teams I've ever played. It was the pleasure of playing against was Chelsea at that time. With Benetti, Shillito, McCready, Tamling, Venables, Osgood. What a team they had.
Charlie Cook,
and they destroyed us.
Yeah.
But they were marvellous players. And the best team, I would say, and obviously Celtic at that time, but Dundee were a wonderful team. And they always caused you problems. At that time, the team that won the league, that was in 1994.
They got the semi-final of the European Cup, which not a lot of people remember. But
they were
fantastic.
They beat St Mirren 9-3 once, and I was playing right back. I cleared three off the line. Cockles, the left back, scored three off the line. Dick Beattie was in goals, and he got the man of the match. And we could beat 9-3. That just shows you
attacking force they had. So, what about? Obviously, you've been involved here at Firth Park, but you've been in many different stadiums and pitches across Scotland and beyond. What's your favourite ground and favourite memory of a match that you played in?
I think what favourite ground. I like Tynecastle, the Troddy. I like playing at Arbroath. Arbroath was a wonderful park. There was a lot of wind there and etc. But the actual surface was a great park. And I remember the first time I ever played against the Rangers, it was a lovely sunny day and it was a love seat. That was a great occasion and we beat them 2-1. That was my first game against them, and George McLean and the Red Campbell scored. And I remember that game, my debut was against Hibs. I remember that game with 3-each. Easter Road, I wasn't too fond of Easter Road, it was in a bit of a dreadful state. And I really do, when you think back, anybody the same vintage as me and even older, around about that area, they always say that football's not the same. It's definitely not the same. There's not the same entertainment. Footballers used to entertain. You'd always two wingers, you could beat people. You're two inside forwards, they were capable of beating people. Two wing halves could score goals, were outstanding passers of the ball. And that was how teams were formed years and years ago. And the thing that annoys me more than anything, in my opinion, is that the coaching in Scotland, to me, is a lot to answer for. Because I've seen it over the years, and coaches will not stand back and let people express themselves. They will not let... And Scotland was famous for the amount of natural players, it had Tanner ball players. Way back, every top team in England had a nucleus of Scottish players who could beat people and were exciting and creative players. And that is slowly gone. And there was a one player I recommended to a senior club, and because he could beat people. First thing, sand dancer, you pass the ball. And it happens right from, in my opinion, right from the word go. In recent years, you can look at the pattern. I think Scottish football compare themselves to successful teams like Barcelona. The Barcelona are a wonderful team because they pass. Every team's want to pass. But in my opinion, they should look at Messi. Messi's the one that can beat people. Why do you not get people go and copy Messi? Go and look at film with George Best, Wally Hunter, Jimmy Jones, all these players, Stanley Matthews. Yeah. How did they beat people? And go back to that. You've watched games at Motherwell. That Livingston game, for example, I've not been derisory about Motherwell, don't get me wrong, but there was not a save in the game. So the fans, they go there to see something different. They go to see shots at the goals, people getting to the byline, crosses, defenders getting beaten by attacking players, but they don't see that now. And that, to me, it's actually quite sad, because you come away from games and you don't feel entertained. The best bit of games nowadays is meeting all your pals before the game and talking about it afterwards. But the actual game, I remember at the school way back, and a class of kids, not too long ago, I says, name me two Scottish players who can regularly beat a defender. One of the brightest class, right enough, and the first one says, Paul Gascoigne. I says, well, he's no English for a start. So I write another Scottish player who regularly beats the defender. Next answer, Ryan Loudrop. I says, wait a minute. But there wasn't anybody. There's nobody. If you go back, you think of the people now, who would you say can go and go double pass somebody? Yeah. It just doesn't happen. And I just quite despair, unless they revert to letting the kids express themselves and give it a try. No matter, everybody thinks they know everything about football. Yeah. And they get maybe a coach that's a badge for a C licence, he thinks he knows everything. And I think in Scotland they don't listen. You think away back to Hungary, 1953, the Hungarian team come over, Real Madrid, and you're supposed to copy what they're doing, and they never ever do. They just go back in their own shell. And they think we started the game, therefore it'll come good. But I think they need to change the whole structure of youth football. Before you
only ask. Hello, Gavin. Hi, how you doing?
Hello,
how are
you doing? All right.
Not bad.
All right, David, should have been
doing here. Yeah.
All right, David.
Hi.
To say
the
answer. I didn't need any help, I'll tell you.
Yeah?
Didn't need any help at all.
Did not.
Excellent. Good. Right. So, and we're going to ask if you could sign. Was it
the program, the program and the photograph?
The program and the photograph.
Saying, there are two copies in there.
So, and we're going to, it was okay, we're going to auction these to raise funds for the Well Society. So, if you wouldn't mind.
There's another one down.
Not at all. Should be two there. Sticking a wee bit.
Yeah, a minute. No.
There's John Martis there. So, if you want, you could lean on the table there.
You could.
Just the sign. And the Sable auction is for Wales Society to raise some money.
Best wishes,
aye.
That'd be great, yeah.
Have a good day. I don't know when they finished up,
but
I came away.
Just anywhere you like, maybe just across the top there, yeah.